thank you very much, Mario, and thank you very much, colleagues in the panel and those who have made it possible for us to be together. So let me try and share my screen. I hope you can see it. Let me know if you do, or more importantly, let me know if you don't.
All perfect.
Okay. So I'm conscious of the time, and being the first, I have to make sure that I do not overrun, so that I leave plenty of time for my fellow panelists. So I'll just try to whiz you through some of the concepts and some of the ideas driving the current work that we're doing at the European level, and in particular within the European Commission, to try and address this question of data governance. Now, I'll not focus so much on the ethics, but more on the governance of data. And why does that matter? From two points of view, both a technological point of view and a geopolitical point of view, I'll put here a reference to a report which published already a couple of years ago, that in a way so tries to cover many of the facets around artificial intelligence, technology in general, and why data governance is important. Now, clearly from a technological point of view, we are in the middle of a digital transformation of our society that really is affecting every aspect from work to education to our social life. And more so at the time of the COVID, we have seen how, you know, sort of digital has enabled us to work in ways that were not possible before, and clearly within this digital transformation we have many different technologies, of which artificial intelligence is one. But Stefan has already introduced the concept of the Internet of Things and digital twins. We're talking in general about robotics automation, of course, cybersecurity is important, etc., etc. And you see all the rest there. So from a technological point of view, there is this galloping sort of change. But at the moment, let's face it, there's also an increasing over the last few years, there's been a lot of increasing geopolitical tension, particularly between China and the United States. And we'll wait and see what the new administration will bring in the US. But certainly this geopolitical context is one that, that has been affecting also and focusing also on technology, artificial intelligence, and data, because at the end, all of these technologies are data dependent. They're all there to help us to analyze and make sense of the vast quantities of data that are becoming now available, and therefore, you know, sort of controlling the data means controlling the technology, and those who control those two clearly have a large say on how society develops. Now, at the global level, I mean, I think that Perot has already given an overview through the AI index, but clearly we see that the United States, China, and Europe are sort of kind of the areas that's where there's the greatest developments as far as artificial intelligence and related. You will see that the European has also a very strong research dimension, which is the gray box on the top of the blue one. So research is and particularly EU-funded research is very important in Europe, where we are not as good as the other countries is somehow translating this research into products and services. So that's where we need to do better. So we have started over the last couple of years the development of a policy framework around artificial intelligence and around data. And so I've highlighted here two of the cornerstones of the European strategy for artificial intelligence in April, where also the appropriate ethical and legal framework was perceived to be a very important European dimension. So we really sort of understood that in a way, sort of we have different paradigms in the US, much more a commercial orientation. In China, there's a very strong link between the commercial sector, civil society, governments, and in Europe, we were looking at what is it that we want to do, and clearly sort of trying to find ways of developing the technology so that it strengthens the underpinning value of the European Union is enormously important, and that's why we have been focusing a lot on the ethical principles, And then there's a plan of actions with all the member states to work together and to fund these developments over the next few years. On ethics, there was a special panel that was set up. We identified these sort of key principles, and then we have developed a set of guidelines and in order to try to measure the extent to which the products and services that are developed or that are coming into the market are complying to these principles. So it's part also of this transparency and quality control of around artificial intelligence. What is happening now? So this year there has been a discussion paper on artificial intelligence that really sort of tried to set the framework for a risk-based approach to regulate artificial intelligence. And we will see that this risk-based regulatory framework will be put in place at the beginning of next year. But we've also seen a great focus on strategy for data, because exactly, I mean, the issue is that if you do not, in a way, exploit better the data that is generated in Europe, then we have a very severe handicap. And this is, again, where you know, we need to recognize that whilst, you know, the data in China is, you know, there's a very strong degree of sovereignty around data in China. For the US, I mean, basically, we are all giving away our data for free. 86% of all searches are done through Google. So, you know, there are four or five companies that basically suck up all the data that is produced around the world, with the exception of China, maybe. But clearly, we see that at this junction, particularly as we are getting more and more into also data coming from sensors, data coming from the commercial sector, industrial data, we need to make sure that European data is exploited better by Europeans to develop European products and services and serve European society. That doesn't mean to close the borders, but means to just be more conscious that about the resources that we generate and the good quality data that we have. So we have a Data Governance Act that is coming into shape next week, and that basically set the framework as well for both actors within the union and anybody else who wants to operate in Europe to operate around this data. Perot has already mentioned that we have an observatory on artificial intelligence called AI Watch. So we are sort of monitoring both the national strategies, the investments, the uptake in the public sector and in industry. And we are looking specifically at robotics, and we are collaborating with the AI Index. So we're contributing some of our analysis to this global index, and we are looking a lot now at standardization, which is again is something that is has a very strong geopolitical dimension, as Stefan, I'm sure, will be able to tell you if you ask him. Let me say something else related to this. We have had a project for the last 3 years where we've been focusing very much on the governance of digitally transformed society from two perspectives, not just looking at what does it mean, governance of new societies? And we very quickly came to the view that it's a lot about the governance of data. And the second thing was to also see, well, what are the new opportunities to govern differently using the digital transformation? So not so much the governance of the digital transformation, but the governance with the digital transformation. And we have been trying to address both of these issues through this project that is coming now to an end, and here I'm just giving you a flavor of some of its findings. At the one level, on data governance, we have identified that there are emerging different models that are coming up from the current one, which, if you want, is called, you know, sort of it's extractivism, or as Zuboff calls it, is surveillance capitalism, where a few global companies are basically monetizing all the value added that is generated by the data that we give away. But there are other models that are coming up, data sharing pool, data cooperatives, public data trust, a greater degree of personal sovereignty. And so it's interesting to see these new models that are starting to emerge. They're still at their infancy, but it's something that we want to incentivize at some point in the stage. We have also been looking at ways of using data differently. And so we've been doing a lot of work around the notion of some, one of the characteristics of this digital transformation and of the commercial exploitation of that is through targeting the consumers and providing personalized offers from a commercial point of view, but also increasingly also, you know, from many perspectives, including voting elections, but certainly trying to influence behavior and create personalized services. So we have tried to look at ways in which we could think of creating personalized policies that are targeted to those who need it most. So go away from this notion of blanket, give the same policy to everyone, have the same principle for everyone, but then try to be more specific about the needs of different people, families, groups, et cetera, so we have been experimenting with that and experimenting a lot also with the notion of synthetic population in order to avoid the targeting based on personal data, but doing it on the basis of need and not of personal data. So a lot of interesting developments there that I'm happy to follow up. Just two more points that I would like to make before I close. One is that we have to be conscious both in terms of the development of and exploitation of the technology and the underlying data of the fact that there are, we are living in a world of inequalities, and these inequalities are increasing. Even in Europe, which is a relatively well-off area of the world compared to many others, we have significant areas of inequalities. What you see in this map is the proportion of human resources with a background in science and technology as a percentage of the economic active population, and you will see that basically you see that the south and the east are a lot worse off than the middle and the north. That means that if you invest a lot in education, which is a good thing, but you also, unwillingly, you may be sort of providing more and more fuel to migration, intellectual migration, and to actually making the poorer regions even poorer than they already have. And therefore, you need to, we need to find strategies of combining education, training, awareness, but also creating job opportunities and trying to address local problems with local solutions. And that's why we are developing this network, which you see in the black dots, of these digital innovation hubs that we are hoping might be one way of dealing with that. COVID has also increased further existing inequalities. It has harmed particularly vulnerable groups like the elderly, obviously, but also children. Children have been badly affected by the closure of many schools. In Italy, we are still at an area where most schools are currently closed. And this is creating big disadvantages, particularly for the more vulnerable society and in many countries. And you can see here in this map is the proportion of people who have access to their local administration, local governments via the internet. And you can see that there is a big difference between, again, the south and the east and the center and the north. And that is one of the many things that is exacerbating inequalities. So we need to develop the technology, we need to develop digital earth and have this vision, but also try to develop it so that it reduces existing inequalities in order to have social sustainability as well as environmental and economic sustainability. So from a European perspective, we need to be vigilant as well as about possible threats to our value and to the increasing sort of differences in the social fabric. But at the same time, we need to work together. We can only work globally, together in order to make sense of this digital future as equal partners. We need to recognize that everyone is trying to do the best for their constituents, which is fair. But let's work together in order to have, sort of a bigger pie that we can always divide rather than increasing the share of one to the detriment of the other. And clearly the new working group that Alessandro has announced this morning on data governance and ethics provides a great opportunity to work together in a global setting like the International Society for Digital Earth, and therefore very much look forward to your contributions to a new membership to this working group. And I'll leave you with this wonderful picture of Il Quarto Stato by an Italian painter of the turn of the 19th century, 20th century. And it really sort of gives a sense of getting up and working together to address these issues. And with that, I will stop, Mario. Thank you very much.